Good morning, good morning, good morning. Now you may wonder, why are the windscreen wipers going and why are the blowers blowing? And the answer is, we had a frost this morning, April the 13th. Yeah, April 13th. So, how are you? How are you? I'm going the slightly faster, slightly straighter way because of the frost. Because the other way, the windy way, is the, you know, you'd like on a nice day, you think, oh, I'll have a little drive through the fields and everything, have a look at the frost on the fields, although it's mostly gone, and then you go round a bend or something where the trees are overhanging the road and everything's frozen solid, and so you end up skidding and hitting a tree. So, and then you think, oh well, that's not going to happen to me. That's not the old classic, you know, things that are very, very consequential but extremely rare. Let's just make sure we don't hit the jogger. Very rarely see any sort of elderly joggers, do you? I suppose in America you do. It's this thing about risk, you know. We ignore it if it's very, very unlikely to happen, even if it would nearly kill us. And we take much more notice of the things that are much more likely to happen, but don't really mean anything. So, anyway, I've just had another grandson yesterday. So I now have 5 grandchildren from 5 out of 2. One's got 2 girls and a boy, 2 boys and a girl, and the other one's got a girl and a boy, so. So I'm very happy about that. Today is a happy day. Sorry about the sun shining in. Well, we'll turn left in a minute. Obviously we're going east in a minute. Well, we're going sort of southeast, and then we'll turn and go pure east. Although I think, now I come to think of it, there is a 4-way traffic light at the end of this road. And those of you who have been driving for a few years will know that of all the traffic lights, all the workmen's lights, oh my goodness, they've closed that road now. The road on the left's closed. The 4-way is the worst. Might have been better to have taken the minute. But God, look at all those things there are for apples. It's a massive great pile of apple containers. They stand there all year, they're not used most of the year, and then around about September they get used. So, how are you? I hope you're well. I hope you're there we go. Oh, someone's got a load of bags in front. What are they doing? They're off somewhere. Oh well, we've got a bit of luck there, didn't we? We only had to wait 10 seconds. Unlike these poor schmucks. Yeah, so I'm well. I mean, we're very busy. Taken on a new receptionist, Ellie. She's a genius, you know, literally, she's been working with us for about 3 weeks, and it's like she's been working with us for 10 years, you know. She just picks everything up straight away, blah, blah. We got her from, she was packing our shelves at Asda when we found her. Had to get up at 2 o'clock in the morning to get in for 3 o'clock in the morning. To do shelf picking. Now, what a waste of a talent like hers, you know. She is so suited to what she does. But I think she might be a polymath, you know. She might be suited to pretty much anything she does. So we'll have to watch out, because she might be a bit too brainy. She might want to leave to become a rocket scientist or something. So, anyway, but that's all going well, and she's happy where she is, and she's just happy she doesn't have to wake up in the middle of the night. Now, let's get some warm air on my feet. That'll do. So what can I tell you about today? Right, well, obviously the surgery's really busy. We booked up 2 weeks ahead, which for us is slightly more than we want. We want to be booked up solid about a week, and then I suppose we are booked up about what we want. We're solid a week, and then we got some spaces next week, you know. I had a brilliant case come in. Bloody people dumping everything. You've probably got the same way you are. The whole journey is punctuated with mattresses and discarded tyres because the social system for discarding rubbish has broken down. You can go down the dump now, but you need an appointment. You can make as many appointments as you like, but you can't just do it on the spur of the moment. And so, whereas you can dump a tyre in a lay-by on the spur of the moment, so you know the service is public service is losing out to the impromptu, the ad hoc waste disposal service, which is to put it in a bus stop. Anyway, where was I? There is a point to this. So yeah, so from an economic point of view, the lockdown was lifted yesterday. There were queues to get in the barbers. Honestly, I don't understand. I mean, I need a haircut. I do not understand why. What would induce me to go and stand in a queue, you know, outside a barber shop, and be like sixth or seventh in the queue, knowing that the barbers take about, I don't know. I mean, no less than 20 minutes to cut someone's hair. My barber's not quick. They're not, you know, barbers are not brain surgeons, are they? Well, with all due respect, they're not. They're barbers because they're, I don't know, they got taught the skill while they were on parole or something. So, they don't understand that. Oh, another load of rubbish. They don't understand that they can't, that they can speed things up. If they've got a big long queue, they can, you know, like if a haircut can take anything from 20 minutes to 40 minutes, then take 40 minutes when you've got someone in who gives you a big tip and there's nobody else in. But if you've got a big queue of people outside the door, then you take 20 minutes, don't you? And believe me, if you're a barber and you can't cut hair in 20 minutes, then you need a bit more practice. Because I used to go to a barber's in Mr. Snips, it was called, very originally, in Tankton, in Whitstable in Kent. And he was famous for a story about an elderly couple who were standing outside his shop, and they agreed that the chap was going to pop in and get his hair cut, and she was going to nip across the road to the greengrocer's and get some, buy some veg for dinner. And she went and stood at the pavement to cross the road. Then after a minute, he came and stood beside her to cross the road. And she said to him, "Did you decide not to get your hair cut in the end?" And he said, "No, I've had it done." I mean, that's how quick old Snippy was. Anyway, I'm not going to rush back. I'm sensible about this. Let the people. It was like the first lockdown, you know, and you had like there was a queue half a mile long outside the local Sainsbury's, and like really, you know, I mean, it was almost as if they'd announced that we were going to be attacked by the North Koreans in 2 days' time, and everybody wanted to, you know, stock up. It was just ridiculous. But people do behave like this, so I'm going to let them get it out of the system, and then I'm going to go along and get my hair cut. Perhaps in a week or two. Yeah. So we've just come out of lockdown. Economically, there's a lot of pent-up energy, financial energy in the system. In America, where they've printed a lot of money and given a lot of it away in these stimulus checks, I think they've given away $3,000 to every single American. and so, a lot of them, like perhaps about a third of them, have spent it. Two thirds of them have saved it up. And as a result, there is, and as a result of all the lockdowns and the fact that nobody's been paying for meals or going to the cinema or gambling or whatever, they've got something like 10% of the gross domestic product saved up, which in America is about $20 trillion. So there's $2 trillion burning a hole in people's pockets. Excess, I think they call it excess domestic savings or something. And the queues outside the shops yesterday tend to support that. In other words, you know, as soon as Primark opened, Primark doesn't have an online sales store, so if you want to buy anything from Primark, that's our local dump, doesn't open till 8:30, and of course it's only 8:27, so 8:22, so people are waiting outside to go in, you know. I mean, he's an idiot. He should have dumped his tyres in a lay-by like everybody else. What's he doing? What's he playing at? Sitting there wasting 10 minutes while they finish their cups of tea. So, yeah, so people are queuing outside Primark. Of course, Primark are desperate for people to flood back in. And all the signs are that it looks like that they will. But at least temporarily, I don't know. I mean, obviously, one day is not a flood, is it? I don't know whether they'll still be flooding in a month's time or something, or when the... and, of course, we've had our own version of stimulus checks. We've had... the local council gave every small business £10,000. And then everyone's furloughed, you know. Getting 70 or 80% of their wages for not doing much. So they reckon that we've got about 9% of our gross domestic product saved up. Flat out. Oh, that makes, in a Twingo. Honestly. That's really funny. That's why I was saying you don't see any old joggers, right? This is life. This is how life works, right? When you're young, you need to pass on your genes. If you don't understand what I mean, then you've got to read a bit of Richard Dawkins. Understand how there's a big evolutionary drive to pass on your characteristics, your genes, and survive to the next generation. So, in order to do that, you have to find someone of the opposite sex, gender, and to do that, you have to be... Oh, there's a high-speed train lot going through the countryside at low speed. So, in order to do that, what you have to do is, if a you're a woman, you have to sort of demonstrate that you've got all the necessary characteristics to nurture a baby to completion, survival. Actually, that's going to our new station. I'll show you our new station. The new station is just over here on the right. This is the that's the railway line I'm just going over now. And the train is slowed down over there. I wonder if they're experimenting with the new schedule. Yeah, and if you're a boy, then you've got to demonstrate that you've got the ability to defend and support the woman for the period that she's pregnant and really for the next sort of 10-20 years or so, to the point where the child is independent and capable of looking after itself. So you get all sorts of big dickery like that, you know, guy driving around in a little Twingo with a I've got a big dick sticker on the back, and lots of risk-taking behaviour, you know, driving fast, and generally tombstoning and jumping off the top of the Hilton Hotel with a parachute on your back and all that to demonstrate how fearless you are. Yeah, a lot of boys get killed in the process. You know, they don't ever make it past the bragging stage because their risk assessment is all wrong. Oh, let me turn my radio on. And then you get to the point where, you know, you're just putting all your assets into bringing up the kids. And then you get to a point where you've got grandchildren and your job really is to make sure that you've got some sort of resources to pass on to your grandchildren. Because at that point, your children have done their job. Dawkins will explain all this. You're not really interested in leaving stuff to your children. What you should do is leave stuff to your grandchildren, because your children have done their job by then. They can't really do much apart from make sure, you know, that they leave their wealth to their grandchildren. So once you understand that, you know, early life is about passing on your genes and later life is about passing on your wealth, then you can start to understand. You get more interested in economics podcasts that tell you things like we can expect a bit of a mini boom because everybody's got 9% of their wealth. Oh, settee on the left. So anyway, we've got this thing, Calaject. It's you may have heard of the wand. The wand is an intraligamentary injection system. It uses a very small needle, goes down the side of the tooth in two areas, mesially and distally, and then pretty well anesthetizes just a single tooth. And then it's got all sorts of bells and whistles on it, like various injection speeds, and it's got a back pressure sensor on it, so it cuts off if you're literally injecting into nothing, which I think is more to protect the injection mechanism than it is to protect the patient. But so, and we've had quite promising results. The first patient we did was a massive great DO, carious DO, upper left 7, which actually had a palatal exposure. And you don't find many DOs with a palatal exposure. Anyway, we put a filling in that and put a glass ionomer in that and told him to give us a shout if it didn't settle down. And then and the next one was an extraction of an upper left 2. We were doing a denture, did an add upper left 2 IR, and used the intraligamental anesthesia to extract the upper left 2. And again, that went fine, you know, that went really well. So we're going to have to, I'll do a full report on it when I've been using it a bit more. But we didn't buy the wand. The wand looks nicer and is, you know, nice design. It looks like someone from Apple's had a go at designing it. Whereas the one we're using is a sort of a knockoff system, I think. Or it's, you know, like a very similar system called Calaject, and it's from Evident. And it's, as I say, it's about £3,000. And what we're going to do is we're going to start advertising it. And I'm not going to advertise it as painless injections. I mean, that I think that they used to advertise it as painless injections and then decided that they weren't going to do that. Because it's obviously quite painfully not painless. But people's expectations are set too high when you say painless. They assume that you're just going to wave a magic wand over them like Sooty and say, "Izzy Wizzy, let's get nummy." And that's it, it's numb. And it doesn't work like that. But initial results are very positive, you know, like a massive great carious exposure and then followed by an extraction. I don't think we could have given it too hard a test, really. But anyway, I'll let you know, see how we go. Hooray, my lovely practice. Right, okay. Nice to talk to you. Talk to you later. Bye.